So hello everyone, my name is Prachi and I hope you all have completed your full test 4 test paper. Okay, so now let's start with the solution of full test 4 of chemistry portion. So here see, question number 51 of section A says that find a molecule that is non-existent. Okay, so for a molecule to be non-existent, what do we know? That its bond order should be 0. Okay, so let's see which of these molecules have the bond order of 0. So first let us write the formula for bond order. What will be the formula for bond order? It will be half into number of bonding electron minus number of antibonding electrons, right? So for helium, let's say for helium, the space here, okay, here we can write. So for helium, okay, for helium, what is the atomic number? Helium, for helium atomic number is 2. Okay, and its configuration comes out to be 1s2. Okay, 1s2. So on drawing the atomic orbital of helium, this is one helium molecule and this is another helium molecule, and this is sigma 1s orbital and this is sigma star 1s orbital, right? So for helium we know that there are 2 electrons in its orbital. So for this helium there are 2 electrons and here it is also 2 electrons. Okay, for sigma 1s the 2 electrons will be filled here, and the sigma star 1s the 2 electrons will be filled here, right? So let's calculate its bond order. So for helium the bond order will be number of bonding electrons, right? So how many bonding electrons are there? This is the sigma star is the bonding molecular orbital and sigma star s is the antibonding molecular orbital. Okay, antibonding molecular orbital. So the bond order for helium, half into number of bonding electrons minus number of antibonding electrons, right? So how many bonding electrons are there? There are 2 bonding electrons. And how many antibonding electrons are there? See, there are 2 antibonding electrons. Okay, so it comes out to be 2 minus 2 is 0 and bond order comes out to be 0. Okay, so this is only I was asking about. For helium the bond order will be 0, therefore it is non-existent. Okay, we can also find out the bond order for others. So the bond order for lithium will be 1 and for carbon and oxygen it will be respectively be 2. Okay, so in this way we can find out that the helium atom has a bond order of 0, therefore it is non-existent. So first helium will be the correct answer, right? For question number 2, just wait a second. For question number 52, okay, for question number 52, what will be the IUPAC name? The IUPAC name of this compound is asked. Okay, so let us see. First, we have to find out the priority, which is given more priority, the ketone group. This is the ketone group, or this is the alkene group. Okay, so we know that the ketone has the higher priority than the alkene group. Okay, so the numbering, how the numbering can be done? It can be done from here. This is the first carbon, this is the second carbon, third carbon, fourth carbon, fifth, sixth and seventh carbon. Okay, seventh carbon is the principal carbon chain, parent carbon chain. Okay, then this is the substituent added here. Okay, this is the ethyl substituent which is added here. So what will be the IUPAC name for this? Okay, and also observe one thing, that there is a cis or trans group present at the fifth carbon. Okay, this the ethyl group which is attached here now, this can show, this is showing cis or trans isomer, cis or trans form. Okay, we have to find out from here. So see, this So like this, this is like this, okay? So this is the, which form is there? This is the transform, okay? And transform is also called the E form. Transform is also called the E form, right? And if the cis form will be there, if the cis form will be there, then there it is Z form. But here we can say that it is the transform, okay? Which means it is the E form is given here. So let us find out the IUPAC quickly. The fifth carbon will have the E form of ethyl, okay? The fifth carbon will have the E form of ethyl, okay? This one. And the parent carbon is of seven carbon atoms, so it will be hept. And at fifth position, an alkene group is the ene, double bond. And at second carbon, there is one ketone group. So which option will be correct? I think the first option is only correct, right? The first option is correct here. Okay, so let's see the next question. Question number 53. In the following reaction, CrO5 plus H2SO4 will give Cr2SO4 whole 3 plus H2O plus O2. How many moles of O2 will be liberated by 2 moles of CrO5? Okay, so we have to find the number of moles. So for that, we have to balance this chemical equation. We have to balance this chemical equation, right? So on balancing, we find out that 4 moles of CrO5 is there and it's reacting with 6 moles of H2SO4. And also, what is the product? The product will be 2 moles of Cr2SO4 whole 3 plus 7O2 plus 6H2O. Okay. So from this balanced chemical equation, what do we find out? That 4 moles of CrO5 will give us how many mole of oxygen? 7 mole of oxygen is given out. Okay, it is only asking the question, right? How many moles of oxygen will be liberated by 2 moles of CrO5? So for 1 mole, we have to find out first, okay? So here we can write, So 4 moles of CrO5 is producing 7 mole of O2, okay? So 1 mole of CrO5, how many it will produce? It will produce 7 by 4 moles of O2, okay? But it is asked in the question that 2 moles of CrO5 will be liberated, okay? So for 2 moles of CrO5, what we can do? We can multiply it by 2. So what will be the answer? It will be 7 by 2 or it will be 3.5. So option number 3 is the correct option, okay? 3.5, okay? For question number 54, which pair is incorrectly matched? Molecule shape or geometry of the molecule, okay? We have to find out that the molecules, the geometry of the molecules is given and which of them is incorrectly marked. So first we have to highlight the incorrect word, otherwise most of you will solve the question as the correct option, okay? Which pair is incorrectly matched? Molecular shape or geometry of the molecule? So let's find out the geometry of all the molecules first. For PCl5 does not follow the trigonal planar geometry. It follows the trigonal bipyramidal geometry. If we draw the structure, this type of structure of PCl5 is observed. Okay, this type of structure is observed and this is the trigonal bipyramidal structure. It is not trigonal planar. So, incorrect answer will be PCl5. It follows the trigonal bipyramidal structure. Let's move on to the next question. Question number 55. Okay, question number 55. Which isomer of dimethyl cyclobutane exhibits optical activity? Which isomer of dimethyl cyclobutane exhibits optical activity? So first we have to draw the structure of dimethyl cyclobutane. Yeah, so dimethyl cyclobutane, this is the cyclobutane and dimethyl group is attached. So let's consider the options first, okay? This is cis-1,2 dimethyl cyclobutane. So for cis, what will be there? Two methyl groups are attached at the cis position. So we can draw two wedges, or we can draw or we can draw like this, okay, two dash. So this will be cis-1,2-dimethylcyclobutane. So this does not show any optical activity, okay, so this option will be incorrect. For the second option, trans-1,2-dimethylcyclobutane. So if we consider trans, then what will happen? One of the wedges bond or one of the dash bond will be converted into opposite one, like here it is dash CH3, then here it is wedge CH3, then another will be dash CH3, here it is dash CH3, then another will be wedge CH3. Okay, this or this structure will be there. So yes, this type of structure will show us the this type of structure will show us the optical activity. Okay, so second option will be correct. Yeah, because this type of compound will show the optical activity, because here it is another group, here it is another group, and here it is another group. So for optical activity, the compound must be compounds must be superimposed, non superimposable. Okay. For question number 56. For question number 56, which of the following is the correct option? Boric acid is considered a weak acid. Diamond is covalent, yet it has a high melting point. Option 3 says that ZSM5 is used to convert alcohols directly into gasoline. And option 4 says halogens have low ionization enthalpy. Okay, so the incorrect option here will be option number 4, because halogens has, option number 4 it is given, halogens have low ionization enthalpy. Okay, but this is not the case. Halogens have little tendency to lose an electrons, and thus they have a high ionization enthalpy. So this option is the option is the correct this option is the incorrect option. Okay, halogens have high ionization enthalpy, it does not have low ionization enthalpy. So this is the correct answer and the incorrect answer, correct option. Question number 57. For question number 57, the mole fraction of the solute in a 1 molar aqueous solution is. So for 1 molar aqueous solution, we have to find the mole fraction. Okay, so we know that 1 molar solution means 1 mole of solute. Okay, 1 molar solution means 1 mole of solute in 1 kg or 1000 gram of water, 1000 gram of water, or say 1000 gram of solvent. Okay, so number of moles in solvent is 1, and the number of moles of solvent we can find out, it is 1000 by 18, that comes out to be 55.5. So we know the number of moles of solvent and number of moles of solute. So now we can find the mole fraction of solute, right, which is number of moles of solute by number of, okay, mole fraction. What is mole fraction? Mole fraction is number of moles of solute by number of moles of solute plus number of moles of solvent. Okay, this is the formula. So here we can say that mole fraction of solute, it is 1 by 1 plus 55.5, that comes out to be 0.01768. okay, and which is nearly equal to 0.0177. question number 57 answer will be option number 3. Okay, clear? Yeah. So for question number 58, what does question number 58 says? The non-aromatic system among the following. So we have to find out the non-aromatic system. Okay, so we know that for non-aromatic system, what is the requirements here? It should be non-planar. Non-planar means it will have an sp3 hybridized carbon atom. Okay, for a compound to be non-aromatic, non-planarity would be required. Okay, so let's find out that which of these have an sp3 hybridized carbon. So in option number 1, here we can see that if this carbon is sp3 hybridized, which means that it is non-planar. Okay, Option number 2 also we can find the sp3 hybridized carbon. In option number 3 also it is a non-aromatic compound. Okay, it is a non-aromatic compound. So this is the most important non-aromatic compound. Okay, few only are non-aromatic and this is one of them which we can remember, which we can try to remember. हम लोग इसको remember कर सकते, याद रख सकते कि this compound, whenever this compound comes, it is always a non-aromatic compound. Okay, this does not exist in this way. This exists in a tub shape molecule. Remember, tub shape molecule की तरह exist करता है ये compound. And this is non-aromatic in nature. Okay, so option number 3 is also non-aromatic, and option number 4 is an aromatic compound. So what is asked in the question? The non-aromatic system. Okay, so option number 1, option 2 and option 3, these three are non-aromatic. So the correct answer will be option number 2 1 2 and 3, right? So let's see the 59 question. 59 question says that how many unpaired electrons are present in Ni+2 cation? Its atomic number is also given, 28. Okay, so for question number 59, we know that the atomic number of nickel is given and its electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d8. So 4s2, 3d8 we have to consider. It is given for nickel, and what will be the configuration for nickel plus 2? It will be 4s, 2 electrons are removed from 4s orbital. Okay, so 4s will be 0 and 3d8 is remaining. So 3d8 is remaining, it means that 8 electrons are to be filled in the orbitals. Okay, in the d orbitals. So let's fill. So like this, if we fill the electrons in the orbitals, then how much unpaired electrons are left? Only 2 unpaired electrons are there. So 2 unpaired electrons are left in case of Ni+2. So here 2 unpaired electrons are left. Okay, it is only asked how many unpaired electrons are there. So 2 unpaired electrons are there. Okay. For question number 60. Which of the following reaction is not classified as a hydrolysis reaction? So for hydrolysis reaction, we have to consider which reaction is not classified as a hydrolysis reaction. Okay, so option number 4 is the correct answer, because in this type of reaction, in 2F2 plus 2H2O gives HF plus O2. What happens that the fluorine oxidizes the water into O2. Okay, so reaction does not comes under the hydrolysis reaction. It oxidizes H2O into O2. It is type of oxidation reaction and it is not considered as a hydrolysis reaction. So option number 4 is the correct answer, and it is not the hydrolysis reaction. Okay, for question number 61, choose the correct statement about the addition of BH3 to carbon-carbon double bond. Okay, so let's see which reaction is involved when BH3 is attacked, when BH3 is reacted to carbon-carbon double bond. Okay, so hydroboration oxidation reaction is a two-step process in which what happens that carbon double bond carbon, it is reacted with BH3. Okay, so let's see the reaction. This type of reaction is called the hydroboration oxidation reaction, and it is a two-step pathway, and it is used to produce what? It is used to produce alcohol. Okay, so the reaction proceeds in the anti-Markovnikov rule. What is anti-Markovnikov rule? It says that according to Markovnikov rules, what happens that the hydrogen is attached to the less hydrogen sorry so what happens in the Markovnikov rule, the negative part will attach to the carbon having less number of hydrogen. Okay, so anti-Markovnikov, the negative part of the radical will attach to the carbon having greater number of hydrogen atom, right? Greater number of hydrogen atom. So here anti-Markovnikov rule is followed, where the hydrogen attaches to the more substituted carbon and the boron gets attached to the least substituted carbon. Okay, boron gets attached to the least substituted carbon in the alkene double bond. This is the anti-Markovnikov rule. So here, see, this type of reaction is there. Okay, this type of reaction is there. The hydrogen gets attached to the more substituted carbon, and the BH2 will get attached, and the boron gets attached to the less substituted carbon. So this type of reaction will be there, and so it follows the anti-Markovnikov rules and also syn addition it follows. For question number 62, which of the compounds listed below exhibits a linear structure? Linear structure is asked. So which of the following exhibits a linear structure? So we can say that N2O. N2O follows the linear structure. This type of structure is there for N2O, and it is clearly the linear structure. Okay. Question number 63. According to the law of thermodynamics, a perfect crystal entropy is zero. According to this law of thermodynamics, it is asked that which law of thermodynamics states that a perfect crystal's entropy is zero at absolute zero. Okay, so we know that from the theory part, we can say that it is the third law of thermodynamics, right? It is directly asked the statement for third law of thermodynamics. The statement is given, and you have been asked that which is the law which is described here. Okay, so the third law is described. Question number 64. How would you distinguish between pent 1-ene and pent 2-ene? Okay, so let's first draw the structure for pent 1-ene. There are 5 carbon atoms, and for one, the first carbon, there is a triple bond. Okay, here it is CH. Here it is CH2, CH2, CH3. This is the pent 1-ene. Okay. And pent 2-ene. What is the pent 2-ene? The second carbon will have the triple bond. Here it is CH3, CH2, CH3. Okay. This is the pent 2-ene. So among these options, which is the reagent which is used to distinguish between pent 1-ene and pent 1-ene and pent 2-ene? Okay, so here we know that alkynes have sp3 hybridized carbon, though this carbon will be sp3 hybridized. Okay, this is sp3 sp hybridized, this and this will be sp hybridized. Okay, this is also sp hybridized. So alkynes have sp hybridized carbon, and which are electronegative in nature also. Thus the hydrogen gets attached to sp hybridized carbon will be acidic. Okay, so the hydrogen which will be attached to the sp hybridized carbon, it will be acidic, and NaNH2, we know that it is a strong base that abstracts hydrogen. So NaNH2 is a base. Okay, and the hydrogen which is attached to the sp hybridized carbon is acidic in nature. Like this is acidic in nature. So what is the work of a base? The base will abstract the acidic hydrogen from the compound, from the pent 1-ene. Okay, so pent 1-ene reacts with base to form a salt. Okay, to form a salt. But it does not do so in the case of pent 2-ene, because there is no acidic hydrogen is there in pent 2-ene. Okay, so it will not react with pent 2-ene, but it will react with pent 1-ene. So option number 3 will be correct. Okay, this is used to distinguish between these two. Question number 65. In the reaction delta S and delta H both are positive. Okay, delta S and delta H are positive, the conditions under which the reaction would not be spontaneous, would not be, highlight the not part here, the reaction would not be spontaneous is, so which of these reaction will is not spontaneous? See the options. First option is delta H greater than T delta S. Second option is delta H equals to delta H by T, delta H equals to T delta S, and all of the above. Okay, so the answer, which is the correct answer, we know that in a reaction delta H and delta S both are positive, it is given in the question. And in the following cases, the reaction would not be spontaneous. The reaction would not be spontaneous in which case? In the first case, delta H is greater than T delta S. Okay, in this case, delta G will be greater than 0, and thus it is a not spontaneous. Delta G greater than 0, it means that it is positive. Delta G will come out to be positive, and we know that if delta G is positive, then the reaction is non-spontaneous. Delta G always have to be negative for a reaction to be spontaneous. Okay. Yeah. So option number first will be the correct option. Delta H is greater than T delta S. Okay. For question number 66. For question number 66, it states that which reaction among the following demonstrate the oxidizing nature of SO2? Okay, the oxidizing nature of SO2, which of the reaction will then demonstrate? So, sulfur dioxide in option number 2. Option number 2 will be the correct option. Let's see why. Because sulfur dioxide acts as an oxidizing agent as it oxidizes H2S to elemental sulfur. Okay. Here sulfur dioxide acts as an oxidizing agent and it reduces H2S to sulfur. Okay. While itself being reduced to the same. Okay. It is oxidizing agent. So sulfur dioxide is an oxidizing agent and it oxidizes H2S to sulfur. Okay, and it itself being reduced. So, it is only asked that which of the following demonstrate the oxidizing nature. So, option number 2. This reaction demonstrates the oxidizing nature of SO2. Okay. Question number 67. For question number 67, the pKa of a weak acid is 4.5. The pKa of a weak acid is given as 4.5. The pOH of an aqueous buffered solution of HA in which 50% of the acid is ionized. So, percentage of acid is given. Okay, percentage of acid and salt is given, we can say, because it is an aqueous buffered solution. So, we will follow the formula for an acid buffer. Formula for an acid buffer says that the pH is equals to pKa plus log of salt and acid. Okay, we can say that percentage of log of salt and acid. So here pH, we have to find the pH, and the pKa is given as 4.5. Log of percentage of salt we have 50% and percentage of acid we have 50%, which comes out to be 4.5. So pH is 4.5, then we have to find the pOH, right? So the pOH is 9.5. Okay, pOH is 9.5. So question number 68. Next is question number 68. A chemical reaction that proceeds by heating sodium phenoxide with carbon dioxide under pressure and then treating the product with sulfuric acid, and the final product is an aromatic hydroxy acid. This reaction is named as. Okay. So we have been asked that a chemical reaction that is proceed by heating sodium phenoxide with carbon dioxide. This is the sodium phenoxide. Okay, sodium phenoxide with carbon dioxide under pressure and treating the product with sulfuric acid, what will be the final product? It is an aromatic hydroxy acid. Okay, we have to find the final product and we have to name this reaction. So the reaction name will be Kolbe-Schmitt reaction. It is a type of addition reaction that starts with phenol and reacting with carbon dioxide we get sodium phenoxide. Okay, and it gives the salicylic acid. it will give salicylic acid as the final product. So this is the Kolbe's Schmidt reaction, option number 2. Option number 2 will be the correct option. For question number 69, which oxide forms the option provided does not react with NaOH? Which of the following does not react with NaOH? Tl2O, okay, thallium oxide. Tl2O, thallium 1 oxide, does not react with NaOH. Option number 3 is the correct option and it does not react with NaOH. Let's see why. Because thallium oxide is a basic oxide, okay, and NaOH is also basic. So if both are basic, then they will only contribute to hydroxide ions, okay. Only hydroxide ions are produced in the solution. So we can say that no further reaction is going on here. So ClO2 is the correct option, okay. This does not react with NaOH. Question number 70 says that if little heat is added to an ice liquid equilibrium in a sealed container, if little heat is added to an ice liquid equilibrium in a sealed container, okay, then what will happen? Its pressure will rise, the temperature will rise, the temperature will fall, or there will be no change in pressure and temperature. So see, when an small amount of heat is added, what happens that a phase change will occur in an ice liquid equilibrium. When we apply a small amount of heat, then what happens that a phase change occurs. Phase change can be in the form when ice will melt to liquid or the liquid will freeze to ice. Okay, it depends on which direction we are applying the heat. So if the system is sealed, the volume will remain constant. The volume will remain constant and there will be no change in pressure in case of the sealed system. Okay, and after the phase change is complete, the temperature change will depend on the direction of heat flow. Therefore, in a sealed container with ice liquid equilibrium, on adding a heat results in no change in pressure and temperature until the phase change is complete. Okay, so if we are considering the case of a sealed container, then there will be no pressure change occurs, okay, until the phase change is complete. So option number 4, no change in pressure or temperature, okay, unless and until the phase change is complete. And consider that it is only in the case of sealed container. In case of an open container, it can be different, it can vary, okay. Question number 71. For question number 71, identify the major product of the following reaction. This is the reactant, okay. Here CH3 and CH3 will be in this carbon, okay. It is put here by mistake, okay. So this is the reactant and it reacts with iodine, I minus, in the presence of DMF to form a product. So it is a, which type of reaction it is? It is a SN2 reaction, and here we can say that primary halide, okay. Let's find out, there are two halides are there. Here it is one Cl and here it is another Cl, and iodine is there. So iodine will attack to one of the Cl and substitute it, okay, substitute and take its position. So which of the Cl will lose its position? So let's find out that which type of halide is there. This Cl is attached to the carbon with the 3 degree, which is tertiary. So this halide is also, this chlorine is also a tertiary halide, and this chlorine is attached to a 1 degree carbon, so it is also a 1 degree halide, okay. So here we can say that the iodine reaction is more susceptible to primary halide, okay. It is more susceptible to SN2 reaction as compared to tertiary halide. So what will happen? The substitution will take place in place of primary halide, okay. So Cl will be removed and the I will be put in its position, okay. So option number 2 will be the correct option. This is nothing, okay. Option number 2 will be the correct option. Yeah. For question number 72, let's see the question number 72. Given below is a half cell reaction. Mn plus 2 plus 2 electrons will give Mn, and its E0 cell potential is given as minus 1.18 volt. Second reaction is Mn plus 3 plus E minus will give Mn plus 2, and its electron potential E0 cell is given as plus 1.51 volt. Okay, So among this, which is the oxidation potential and which is the reduction potential? -1.18. This is the reduction half cell. Okay, this is the reduction half cell, and +1.51. This is the oxidation half cell. And what we have to find? We have to find the E naught cell. So E naught cell, the formula for E cell. What is the formula for E cell? It is E naught of reduction minus E naught of oxidation. Right. So only put the values of reduction and oxidation. So reduction value is -1.18 and oxidation value is -1.51. So E cell comes out to be -2.69 volt. Okay, so -2.69 volt, option number 1 and 2 gets cancelled, and option number 3 and option number 4 is there. And in this case, the reaction will not occur. It is not possible because delta G is positive in this case. Okay, delta G is positive, so the reaction will not occur. Option number 3 will be the correct option. Next is question number 73. Which of the following does not correctly show the order of the indicated property? Okay, which of the following will not show the order of the indicated property? Okay, so for question number 63, the elements listed are Ti, V, chromium, manganese. Okay, the correct order of the increasing melting point would be, so melting point, increasing melting point is the order it follows is Ti is less than V, less than chromium, less than manganese. Okay, which aligns with the provided option 1. Option number 1 will be the correct. The increasing melting point, it is the correct option. It is not correct option. It is not correctly. Okay, Ti should be greater than V, then chromium, then manganese. Increasing melting point, it is not the correct option. Okay. Question number 74. For question number 74, it is asked that which solution will have the highest boiling point? Which solution will have the highest boiling point? 1% glucose in water, 1% sucrose in water, 1% CaCl2 in water, and 1% NaCl in water. Okay, so we know that the highest boiling point, which compound, which ion will have the highest melting point, which have the greater number of ions. So more the number of ions, more will be the Van't Hoff factor, I, and more will be the boiling point. So 1% CaCl2, it will have the greatest number of ions and therefore it will show the maximum boiling point. So 1% CaCl2 is the correct option. Question number 75. The reaction of phenyl benzoate with an excess of magnesium bromide gives a mixture of. Okay. So okay, let's draw this first. The reaction of phenyl benzoate. So phenyl benzoate, this is the product, this is the reactant. Okay, this is phenyl benzoate and it's reacted with excess of methyl magnesium bromide. Okay, this is the methyl magnesium bromide and it will give the product. The product is asked, so the product here will be okay, this type of product is obtained. It is 2-phenyl propane 2-ol. Also another product is obtained, which is a phenol. Okay, this is a phenol. So two type of alcohol is formed by this reaction. So the option, correct option will be option number 2, right? 2-phenyl propane 2-ol and phenol, these two are obtained on the reaction, on this reaction. Okay, for question number 76, metals have a conductivity of the order. So metals, the conductivity of the metals is asked. Okay, this is a completely theory based question. You have to learn this order, conductivity order. Okay, conductivity order value. So it is around 10 to the power 8. metals have a very high electrical conductivity as compared to other metals, and the typical order of magnitude for the conductivity of metals is around 10 to the power 8. Okay, so answer here is given as 1, or answer should be 2. Option number 2 is 10 to the power 8. Okay, this is the correct order of conductivity. Question number 77. When sucrose is boiled with dilute HCl, we get what are the products which we get when sucrose is boiled with dilute HCl? So sucrose formula is C12H22O11. So sucrose, when it is boiled with H2O and HCl, it will give glucose and fructose. So glucose and fructose, option number 1 will be the correct option. Okay, sucrose is a disaccharide which will give glucose and fructose as monosaccharide. Okay, question number 78. Question number 78 says that the vapor pressure of toluene is 59.1 torr at 313.75 Kelvin and 298.7 torr at 353.15 Kelvin. Calculate the molar heat of evaporation. So the molar heat of evaporation can be calculated by using the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Okay, Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So what is the Clausius-Clapeyron equation? It is ln of P2 by P1 equals to delta H of vaporization by 2.303 R and minus 1 by T2 by 1 minus 1 by P1. This will be the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Okay. So P2 is given as 300 and P1 is given as 59. Delta H value we have to find heat of vaporization, and 2.303 into R is the gas constant that P1 and T2 are given respectively. So on calculating all this, we get the heat of vaporization, delta H vaporization value as 37.3788 joule per mole. Okay, 37.88 joule per mole. Option number 1 is the correct option. Question number 79. For question number 79, the chloroform and ethanolic KOH are utilized as reagent in which the in which of the following reaction? Okay, chloroform and ethanoic KOH we have to find. So in Hoffman carbylamine reaction, in the Hoffman carbylamine reaction, primary amines react with chloroform and ethanoic KOH to form isocyanates. Okay, or carbylamines. So in option number 4. Okay. Hoffman carbylamine reaction. In Reimer-Thymer reaction also, the phenol react with chloroform and ethanoic acid to yield salicylic acid. So option number in Hoffman carbylamine and in Reimer-Thymer reaction. Okay, so option number A and C. So in these two reaction, chloroform and ethanoic are utilized as a reagent. Okay. For question number 80, in question number 80, arrange NaRbR and magnesium. Arrange sodium, rubidium, potassium and magnesium in ascending order of their atomic radii. So for atomic radii, first use this type of mind diagram to locate the position of elements. Okay. So from here we can easily find out the order of their atomic radius. So we know that the magnesium and sodium are in the same period. Okay, magnesium and sodium are in the same period, but the magnesium is on the right of sodium, which means that it has the greater atomic radii. So atomic radii of magnesium is greater than sodium. Okay, sodium, potassium and rubidium are all in group 1. Sodium, potassium and rubidium, these three, sodium, potassium and rubidium, all in group 1, which is the alkali metal. And on moving down this group, what happens that sodium, potassium and rubidium, their atomic radius increases. And if we move down to the alkali metals group, then what will happen? The atomic radius increases. Therefore, on looking upon all these criteria, the order of the atomic radii comes out to be magnesium will have the lowest atomic radii, then sodium, then potassium, then rubidium. Okay, clear? So option number 2 will be the correct option for this question. For question number 81, for an exothermic chemical reaction occurring in two steps, A plus B to X is a slow step and x to a plus b is a fast step. The progress of the chemical reaction can be best described by. Okay, we have to choose the correct graph. So a plus b to x is a slow reaction. Okay, so if it is a slow reaction, then its activation energy curve will be higher. It will increase and the energy peak will also increase. Okay, which means that for a slow reaction, its activation energy curve will increase. So here it is only one energy curve, and here the activation energy curve is decreasing, and in this case it is increasing. So option number 2 will automatically be correct. But let's discuss the second option also. X to A plus B is a fast reaction. So in this case, what happens that its activation energy curve, it will decrease, and its energy peak will also decrease. Okay, so it will decrease. Option number 2 will be the correct option in this case. Okay. For question number 82. For question number 82, the correct statement regarding a carbonyl compound with a hydrogen atom on its alpha carbon is, which will be the correct statement. A carbonyl compound with a hydrogen atom on its alpha carbon never equilibrates with its corresponding enol. A carbonyl compound with a hydrogen atom on its alpha carbon rapidly equilibrates when it is corresponding, means it is asking for its keto and enol form. Okay, so for an keto and enol form, what happens that if we consider a example. Okay, this is a carbonyl compound, these are the acidic hydrogen, and this is the keto form, and it equilibrates with its enol form. So enol form, what happens that this alpha hydrogen, it is moved to the oxygen. So here it will be OH, and here it will be double bond, and one alpha hydrogen is there. So for a keto enol form, this is the enol form. For a keto enol form, one alpha hydrogen must be there. Okay, so option number 4, I think option number 4 will be the correct. Yeah, let's read out first. Carbonyl compound with a hydrogen atom on its alpha carbon rapidly equilibrates with its corresponding enol. In this process, it is known as ketoenol protoplasm. Yeah, it is the correct option, because one alpha hydrogen is required for a compound to equilibrate to its enol form. Okay, so here one alpha hydrogen is there, so it will form a enol form, and these both will be in equilibrium with each other. Okay, option number 4 will be the correct option. Question number 83 says that the IUPAC name for PtNH3O3BrNO2Cl is. So in this case, what will be the correct option? So for bromide is used for ammonia. It is used as triamine because 3 ammonia are there, and for NO2 it is used nitrite. Metal is the platinum 4, and on combining all this, we find that the correct answer for this IUPAC nomenclature is triamine bromo chloro nitro platinum 4 chloride. So option number 3 will be the correct option. It is the direct IUPAC question. Okay, we have to, if you know the rules of IUPAC nomenclature na, for coordination compounds, then this is the most easiest question. Okay, in question number 84, a hypothetical reaction A2 plus B2 will give 2AB. Mechanism is given below. So A2 on equilibrium with A plus A will give a fast reaction, and A plus B2 will give AB plus B. It is a slow reaction, and A plus B will give AB. It is a fast reaction. Okay, so we have to find out the overall reaction order. We have to find out the order of reaction in this. So let's consider the reactions one by one. The slow step is a rate determining step. Okay, the middle one is the slow step. So for this, the rate is equals to K concentration of A by concentration of B2. A is the intermediate here, so A can be determined as the equilibrium step. For the second reaction, which is the fast reaction, K equilibrium is given as A power 2 by concentration of A2, and concentration of A is given as K equilibrium half by A2, and it is also half of order. So substituting A in equation 1, what we will do, we will substitute the equation of value of A. We have substitute the value of A in equation 1. So R comes out to be this, and then we can find out the order of reaction and it comes out to be 1.5. So answer option number 3, which is 1.5, which is the correct option. Okay, next is question number 85. What is the total number of optically active products obtained when 2-methylpentane is monochlorinated? So 2-methylpentane, when it is monochlorinated, what will be the total number of products obtained? So this is the structure of 2-methylpentane. So this is the structure of 2-methylpentane. And if it is monochlorinated, means one chlorine is attached and or you can say substituted, okay. So here this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 molecules are possible in this reaction, okay. And we have to find out that what is the total number of optically active products. Optically active, so first let's search for the chiral carbons. So for chiral carbon, see here it is one chiral carbon.
So oxidation number, yes, or it is valency also plus 2. So CO2 on reaction with carbon, which is in a graphite form, will give carbon monoxide. Okay. So initial pressure is given, initial pressure of CO2 is 0.5 atm. And the final pressure, what will be the final pressure? 0.5 minus x and will be 2x. Okay. Given that the total pressure of barium is given, it is 0.8 is given, it is the total pressure. So P at equilibrium minus 0.5 minus x plus 2x will give 0.8. X comes out to be 0.3. Change in concentration of CO2 is 0.3 moles. Okay. But what we have to find? We have to find the value of K. Pressure of CO2 at equilibrium is 0.2 and pressure of CO2 at equilibrium is 0.6. Now we can use this to calculate the equilibrium constant. Equilibrium constant is concentration of CO2 by concentration of CO2. Concentration of CO2 kya aayega? 0.6. Okay, 0.6 and concentration of CO2 kya aayega? 0.2. So here we will get the equilibrium constant as 1.8. In which of the following cases the stability of two oxidation states is correctly represented? Okay. So question number 92. Manganese can exhibit a binding order that manganese, the oxidation state of manganese varies from plus 2 to plus 7 and Mn2 plus is more stable than Mn3 plus because Mn2 plus has half Md5 electron configuration. Okay. So it is more stable. So here Mn plus 2 stability is greater than Mn plus 3. We are talking about the stability. Okay, it is correct. Next, while Mn has a higher oxidation state, it requires a new correctly represented it after. Yes, so this is the correct option. Mn plus 2 has higher stability than Mn plus 3. Yeah. The quantum number of 4 electrons are given. Question number 93. Quantum number of 4 electrons are given. So, for this type of question, what we can do that we can remember the laws or you can see steps that are used to follow by writing the quantum numbers. Okay. So, electron 1, electron 2, electron 3 and electron 4. Quantum number. Okay, this have when compared to option number 1 and 4, and option 4 will have the greatest energy because it has the greater azimuthal quantum number than electron 1. So what will be the correct decrease in energy order? So the most electron which has the most energy or electron number 2, then इलेक्ट्रॉन नंबर 3, देन इलेक्ट्रॉन 4 एंड देन इलेक्ट्रॉन 1. ओके, सो दिस ऑर्डर इज देयर इन ऑप्शन नंबर 4. ऑप्शन नंबर 4 इज द करेक्ट ऑप्शन. फॉर क्वेश्चन नंबर 94, द मेजर प्रोडक्ट ऑफ द फॉलोइंग रिएक्शन. मेजर प्रोडक्ट ऑफ द फॉलोइंग रिएक्शन. ओके, सो इस टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चंस में बहुत सारे लोगों को देखे रहते हैं, ठीक है, बहुत बच्चे इस टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चंस से बहुत डरते हैं. बट द मेन रीजन, द मेन इंग्रेडिएंट यू कैन से इज रिमेंबरिंग दिस टाइप ऑफ रिएजेंट्स. ये सारे रिएजेंट्स किस काम में आते हैं, जस्ट फोकस ऑन दैट, जस्ट ट्राई टू रिमेंबर दैट एंड देन यू कैन सॉल्व दिस टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चंस वेरी इजी. ओके, सो दिस इज द कंपाउंड गिवन, दिस इज द रिएक्शन गिवन, एंड यू हैव टू डू द थ्री रिएक्शंस साइमल्टेनियसली. So on reaction with KOH, aqueous KOH, what does aqueous KOH do? This OH will substitute the bromine atom here. Okay, this OH will substitute the bromine atom. Then again CrO3 is reacted and then this carbonyl group is attached here. Carbonyl group is formed here. And then H2SO4 is reacted and heated simultaneously. The cyclization reaction will happen. Okay, cyclization reaction will happen here. And option number 2, option number 3, yeah, option 3 will be the correct option in this case. Okay. So the direction of dipole moment will be towards the more electronegative atoms. So fluorine here is more electronegative, so the direction will be like this. And all the directions are opposite to each other, which means that the dipole moment will be zero here. Next is beryllium difluoride. So beryllium is here and two fluorine atoms are there. Okay. The direction will be towards the fluorine atom and the dipole moment will also be there because both are opposite to each other and both are canceling each other, right? Next is carbon dioxide. So for carbon dioxide also, the dipole moments will cancel each other. And for 1,4 dichlorobenzene, this is the chlorine, okay. And the direction is like this. So for 1,4 dichlorobenzene, the dipole moment is also zero. So option number 4, all of these will have zero dipole moment. For question number 96, which of the following represents the correct increasing order of acidic behavior of the molecules given below, ethyl, benzene and hexane? So we have to find out the acidic behavior. Okay, so acidic behavior is directly proportional to the percentage of S character. Okay, so if the percentage of S character is greater, automatically the acidic behavior will also be greater than that compound. So hexane. Hexane has the least acidic character. Okay, percentage of character is only 25% in hexane. Then in benzene, benzene has 33.33% acidic character. All you can say percentage S character, and ethyl is also having 50%. So the percentage S character is the greatest in ethyl, then benzene, then hexane. Therefore, the acidic order is also greatest for ethyl, then benzene, and then hexane. Okay, so option number 2 will be the correct option for acidic character. Question number 97. Against the following free radical in decreasing order of their stability. Decreasing order of stability, okay, A, B, C. Okay, so for decreasing order it is like this. A, B, S, C. The arrow will be like this, okay. C, A, B. B, A, C. And A, C. Okay, so like this. So the carbocations are there and free radicals are there. So first consider that which type of free radicals are there. This is the tertiary free radical, this is primary and this is secondary free radical. Okay. So the tertiary free radical will be the most stable. followed by secondary by the primary. Why? Because of hyperconjugation. Okay, the tertiary one will have the highest hyperconjugation and it will be most stable. Okay, so stability, we can consider stability. The 3 degree will be most stable. Then 3 degree will be the most stable. Then 2 degree, then 1 degree. Okay, so stability, which means that the stability will be greatest for
Okay, so thank you so much.
थैंक यू सो मच स्टूडेंट्स, कीप लर्निंग।